Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 23. But let me begin with a true story. Robert Robertson was born in England in the 19th century. He came to Christ under the ministry of a powerful evangelist by the name of George Whitfield, who was a mighty man of God. Robert Robertson was a very highly gifted man. He felt God calling him into the ministry, and as he ministered, as he preached, his star rose, and it rose. He was gifted in many ways, but unfortunately, Robert Robertson fell. He fell into immorality, fell into sin. And as he fell into sin, his star faded just as quickly as it rose. He left the ministry. He was riding one day on a stagecoach, sitting by a lady, a stranger that he did not know. She was reading a passage in a book, and she turned to him and said, "Sir, I'm reading some very interesting lines, and I wonder what you thought about them. I'd like to know what you think about these particular lines. Perhaps we could discuss them. I would love to know your thoughts about them." Here is what she read to him. "Come, thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy praise. Streams of mercy never ceasing, calls for songs of loudest praise." She said, "Sir, what do you think about that?" He looked away. He tried to change the subject. She brought it back to him and said, "Sir, what do you think about those lines?" And Robert Robertson bowed his head in shame. And he said, "Ma'am, I am the poor, miserable creature who wrote those lines." You see, Robert Robertson had wrote that song. And perhaps almost as a prophecy, he wrote another part of that song that foretold of his great failure, of his departure from the things of God, when he wrote, "Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above." I want to ask you a question this morning. Has there been a time in your life when you have felt closer to God than you do now? Let me ask it again. Has there been a time in your life where you felt closer to God than you are right now? Was there a time when God was more real to you than he is right now? Perhaps you've been so eaten up with guilt that the devil has convinced you that there's no way back, that God's finished with you. And I want to ask you, do you desire to now be back where you once were? To even go further, to be closer to God? If so, then I believe in today's text, we have it clearly spelled out for us. We have a way back to God, or a way through the guilt to God, in the story of the birth of Christ. Now, in order to discover this way to God, this way through the guilt back to God, we need to begin with a couple of honest confessions. Do you believe in confession? They say that confession is good for the soul. So let's admit. Can some of us admit, who've heard the Christmas story for some time now, for years, that we have lost the sense of wonder in it all? Can we admit that? Those of you who have heard the Christmas story year after year after year after year, can you admit, can you confess, Lord, I've lost some of the wonder, some of the wonder of it all. We've lost that freshness of this tremendous thing that has happened. And the question is, how can we recapture it? I want to suggest to you that you can recapture some of that freshness by looking at the story of the birth of Christ through the eyes of another. Today we're going to consider it through the eyes of Joseph. And I believe by doing so, it will help us to recapture a sense of that wonder. That's the first confession, that perhaps we've lost some of the awe of it all, the wonder of it all. Second confession, can you admit that the Christmas story seems a bit, shall I say, odd? A virgin giving birth to a king who is God in a barn, laying him in a food trough, while an entire crew of angels sings to the lowest class of people in the land. Does that not seem a bit odd? I know we have some honest folk in the house. Listen, if you're honest, that sounds like the stuff of fairy tales or fictional books. Let's be honest to our own logic. The story of the birth of Christ doesn't make sense to our logic. Listen, you know that it's not humanly possible for a virgin to have a baby. Can someone nod and give me some degree of amen or something that you're really tracking with me? We know that's humanly impossible, right? We know that kings aren't born in barns. We understand. And we ask, why in the world would angels sing to shepherds? And why in the world is there this big ball of fire in the sky? You know, this something happening overhead, signaling to these wise men that this is where the Christ child will be born. Why in the world is that happening? Listen, if the story of the birth of Christ is true, then it must be something big. It must be something very big. It's much more than Christmas lights and eggnog and warm fuzzies and Bing Crosby, you know, chestnuts roasting on an open fire. Jack Frost nipping at your nose. It must be something more, right? More than that. The story of the birth of Christ is either the trippiest fantasy ever told, or it is the story of something that is life-altering. It can't be trite. It's either nuts or it's absolutely captivating. It's either a lie or the deepest truth that we can ever know. Make no mistake about it, the story of Jesus is essential for us. Absolutely essential. Because, as we shall see in the text, Jesus and Jesus alone brings the forgiveness that we need. And he makes it possible for us to have the fellowship with God that we were created for. This passage can best be unpacked in two parts, okay? In part one, we'll consider the confusing situation. The confusing situation. In part two, we'll consider the divine revelation. And in each of these parts, we will see wonderful, fresh insights as to why Jesus is so essential for us. So let's first of all consider part one, the confusing situation. Now let your eyes drop to verse 18 and pay attention now, because this is very important for all of us to understand. These verses present Joseph's side of the story prior to the birth of Christ. Now, if you want Mary's side, you go to the book of Luke. Luke chapter 1, verses 26 and following gives Mary's side. But this is Joseph's side. And remember now, there's always two sides to the story, right? There's always two sides. And the Bible tells us that every fact is confirmed on the basis of two or three witnesses. Here is Joseph's perspective. Now, what do we find here? We find here in verses 18 and following two things. First, we find that Mary and Joseph were betrothed. And then second, we find that Joseph thought he had been betrayed. That's the setting from which we discover why Christ is essential. Verse 18. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child by the Holy Spirit. Verse 19. And Joseph, her husband, being a righteous man, not wanting to disgrace her, did something. What did he do? He planned to send her away. How? Secretly. Now, what a confusing situation. What a confusing situation. It's really not hard to see the drama and the difficulty of the opening scenes of the story of Christ, right? So let's get on the scene. First of all, it says that Mary and Joseph were betrothed. What does that mean? That they were betrothed. Well, betrothal in the day and time of the Bible meant much more than dating in our day or an engagement in our culture. When you were betrothed in their culture, it was a promise in marriage. It was a period of time prior to the actual wedding or marriage. But you were considered to be formally related as husband and wife during this time. But the marriage ceremony had not yet taken place. And so we discover that Mary and Joseph were betrothed. And my son and I, my older son and I, Jordan, we had a discussion about this the other day. I believe in the betrothal process. I wish that we still practice that in our day and time. He doesn't seem to believe it'll work. But I believe that it is a good thing. Now, this couple, as they were betrothed, now keep in mind, they did not engage in married or marital relations. During this time, they were pure. And this passage before us tells us that. It emphasizes that they were pure. It says before, verse 18, before they came together, meaning they had not come together in intimate marital relations. They were not cohabitating. They were not shacking up during the time. They were pure during this time. It's very important for us to remember. And that's a good word, really, for all the young people in the house who are not married, who would think that the world has something to offer to you at this point. I want to say to you, you don't have to listen to the opinions of a world in darkness, which says you can't be pure and be happy. No, no. Mary and Joseph were pure, and God was happy to bless them. And you can be pure, and God will be happy to bless you as you follow his will. Now, if you put the gospel events, these events, in some sort of timeline, let me try to combine the gospel record and give you a timeline of what's happening. All right, track with me carefully. First, they were betrothed. Shortly thereafter, the angel Gabriel reveals to Mary that God's purpose was to use her womb as the vehicle to bring the Son of God into the world. Luke 1. Mary confesses to the angel that she does not understand. She's confused. Why? Because she's a virgin. She's a virgin. Next, the angel explained to her that the miracle would be accomplished by the Holy Spirit, so that the offspring, the holy child, would be called the Son of the Most High. Eventually, what happened was that Mary kept this information to herself. She did not tell Joseph of the message, but she went right away and visited a relative, Elizabeth and Zacharias, and she stayed with them for 3 months. Are you tracking with me? They're betrothed. An angel comes. You're going to be the vehicle for the Son of God. She's confused. The angel explains it's going to happen by the Holy Spirit. She doesn't tell anyone. She goes to visit relatives. 3 months. 3 months' time. Apparently, she returns home after 3 months' time, and it's obvious that she's pregnant. She's showing. Now, Joseph finds out she's expecting a child. And he naturally assumes what? She's been unfaithful to me. It breaks his heart. No doubt it breaks his heart. And he begins to think, okay, what am I going to do with this situation now? And this is what we find in verse 19. And Joseph, her husband, being a righteous man and not wanting to disgrace her, planned to send her away secretly. A distressing circumstance, a confusing situation. Think about it. Christmas almost begins with a divorce. It almost begins that way. Joseph is beside himself. The woman that he loves apparently has been unfaithful to him. He begins to consider what to do. And we're told in this passage, he was a just man and he didn't want to publicly humiliate Mary. And so what he decided to do was simply to seek a divorce quietly. That's the context. That's the setting. That's the situation. What do we learn? We learn this, at least this, is that although their circumstances were confusing, although the circumstances were distressing, God had a plan in the circumstances. And he has a plan in your circumstances too. He may not be planning to use you to bring the Savior into the world. That's already happened. But he does have a plan to bring the Savior into your heart. And not only into your heart, but to help you understand him in your life. Sometimes that plan, dear friends, involves confusion, distress, difficulty. One could easily look back over the gospel accounts and see how God uses confusing circumstances and difficulty to bring people to a knowledge of himself. You think of the Samaritan woman, the centurion whose son was ill, the woman with the hemorrhage, the man born blind, all of them facing confusing and difficult situations. But God had a plan to bring them to himself. We can look through history. History bears the same witness. It's the same throughout history. We look at many who wrote hymns for us. Amazing Grace, John Newton, William Cooper, God Moves in Mysterious Ways. The list could go on and on. They were in difficult, distressing situations, and God used that to bring them to himself. Now, your situation does not have to be difficult in order for you to come to know God. You may not be going through a difficult time right now, and you can still know him. But if you are going through a confusing time right now, watch out. God may be about to reveal himself to you in a special way. Robert Service describes the experience of many when he wrote these words. I sought him On the purple seas, I sought him on the mountain peaks. I sought him amid the gloom of giant trees and canyons lone, I called his name. The wasted years of earth I trod, in vain, I found not God. Then after roamings far and wide, in streets and seas and desert wild, I came to stand at last beside the deathbed of my little child. And lo, as I bent beneath the rod, I raised my eyes, and there was God. You know, some people never look up until they're flat on their backs. But more than one person has found faith in God through suffering and sorrow and confusing and difficult times. Such is where we find Joseph. Perhaps it's where you are today. We move now from the confusing situation to the divine revelation. Notice what the text says to us in verse 20. But when he had considered this, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child who has been conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. Now, when it says in verse 20, at the beginning of verse 20, when he had considered this, that's Matthew's shorthand way of saying that God knew Joseph's thoughts. God knew his thoughts. And he knows what you are thinking right now. He knows what you're thinking. He knows what you're considering. He knows whether you want to do the right thing or the wrong thing right now. He knows. God knows. I said, God knows. According to the gospel accounts, again, we are not told whether Mary ever informed Joseph of Gabriel's message. But you know, it really doesn't matter. Because the only way Joseph was going to be convinced that she had not been unfaithful was that God had to reveal the truth to him. Now think about it for a second. From a human perspective, your fiance goes away on a short trip for 3 months. When she comes back, she's pregnant. Come on now. You know you haven't been intimate with her. So what do you naturally assume? She's been intimate with someone else. You naturally assume that. Now, she could tell Joseph anything she wants. And if I put myself in Joseph's shoes, I'm not going to believe anything she says. Right? She comes back. I hadn't been with her. She comes back pregnant. Now, what is she going to say to me that's going to convince me that she has been faithful? Let's take this a step further. If my fiance goes away for 3 months and comes back pregnant and then tells me that God caused it, listen, I'm not only going to question her integrity, but I'm going to question her sanity, right? I'm going to question, I mean, is she really got it together? But that's exactly what took place. And the truth of the matter is that God knew that Joseph would not believe it. So God revealed himself in three distinct ways that I want you to see in our text. God revealed his will to Joseph personally, because God's revelation is always personal. God's revelation, secondly, is always Christ-centered. We'll see that in just a moment. And God's revelation is always scriptural. It's always biblical. I want you to see all three of those things in the text. First of all, I'd like you to notice the personal nature of God's revelation. Verse 20, when he had considered this, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child who has been conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. This miracle was so astounding, so unbelievable, that regardless of what Mary told Joseph, I don't think he would have ever believed her. And so God revealed the truth to him personally. You see, if God could reveal his truth to Mary, he could reveal it to Joseph. And that's exactly what he did. Now, how did he do it? Well, he sent an angel to him, and literally the angel really said, Joseph, what Mary has told you is true. It's really hard for us to really comprehend how glad Joseph's heart must have been when he heard that. That is, that the woman that he loved was telling the truth, that perhaps they could go forward now in their relationship. But God revealed the truth to him personally. Now stop for a moment. Let's do some application. God's plan involves revealing his will through his word to you personally. Not to your friend only or to your Christian parents only, but God wants to reveal himself to you personally. To you personally. God wants you to know the truth for yourself. It's a part of the plan of salvation. I read it to you earlier in the opening passage in Hebrews chapter 8. God wants those who belong to him to all know him personally. God doesn't want you to have a secondhand faith, a secondhand experience. Now, in this case, God used an angel to speak to Joseph in a dream. In the Bible, God often used dreams as a means of communication with men. We see it with Nebuchadnezzar, we see it with Daniel, we see it with Joseph of the old and Joseph here in the new. But his primary way of communicating to people today is not through dreams, but through his word. Through his word. Now in Joseph's case, he used a dream and he used also an angel. An angel is a messenger of God. And God uses angels today to help his children, but his primary messengers today are not angels, but ministers, pastors, evangelists, teachers, and Christians who take the message of the good news of Christ. As we preach and teach from his word, the Bible teaches that God will take that message and by the Holy Spirit's power make his plan known to you personally. And so we see God's revelation was very personal, but I'd like you to see in the second place that God's revelation was Christ-centered. It was Christ-centered. The theological word that we use in our realms of study is it was Christological. It was Christ-centered. I'd like you to see that in verse 21. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. Now listen to this. For he will save his people from their sins. What a revelation. What is the revelation? The revelation is simply this, that Mary will bear a son. This speaks not only of our Savior's humanity, but it speaks also of his deity. The prophet Isaiah, some 600 years before this event, foretold of it when he put it this way in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. For a child will be born to us, and a son will be given to us. A child is born. That's his humanity. A son will be given. That's his deity. That is to say that he preexisted before he was born as the second person of the Trinity, the eternal Son. Before he took upon himself a human nature, the Bible says that he existed forever as God. Now, Jesus, undiminished deity, true humanity, is united in one person forever. That's the revelation. It's a revelation about his person, but not only his person, but notice the text, verse 21, but about his work, his mission. You shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. What's in a name? There's a lot in a name. Jesus is called by his name 500 times in the gospel. In the New Testament, the name Jesus appears over 900 times. The name only has two syllables, five letters. It's pronounced the same in almost every language. It simply means Jehovah saves. There is no word that is sweeter to a person who is a Christian than the name of Jesus. Bernard of Clairvaux expressed this well when he wrote these words: Jesus, the very thought of thee, no voice can sing, no heart can frame, nor can the memory find a sweeter sound than thy blessed name, O Savior of mankind. The Christmas name of our Lord is Jesus. First and foremost, his name is Jesus. It's a very easy name, but it's an exalted name. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 20 and 21, I'd like you to write those verses down. Ephesians 1, verses 20 and 21, it reads this way: which God worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand of the in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but in the age to come. How exalted is the name of Jesus? It is far above every name that has been named or that will ever be named. It is the highest name of all names in all the world for all time. It is the number one name given among men, the name Jesus. Philippians chapter 2, verses 9 through 11, Paul wrote these words: therefore God also highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those in heaven and those on earth and those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The name of Jesus is the most important name in all the world. It's a very easy name. It's an exalted name. It's a very exclusive name. When I hear the name of Jesus, my ears perk up, because that's the name of my Savior. It is the most blessed name in all of the earth, but it's also a very exclusive name because it tells us about his mission. And what was his mission? He was the one who was to come into the world to be the Savior of the lost, and the lost is all mankind. This is why this name of Jesus is exclusive. It's one of a kind. And there never has been, nor will there ever be, anyone who can do what Jesus came to do. Now, what did he come to do? The text tells us he came to do something in particular. What? To save his people from their sins. There are many deliverers in Israel's history, you know. Moses was somewhat of a deliverer. David was considered somewhat of a deliverer. Nehemiah was considered somewhat of a deliverer. All of these men were deliverers in their own right. But they could only deliver from the temporary oppression of another nation or enemies of the nation. Now, let's not assume that Joseph understood what the angel meant. When Joseph heard this angel speak these words, he probably thought what every other Jew thought. And that was that the Messiah was going to come and he was going to save the Jewish nation. that he would save the Jewish nation from suffering under Roman oppression. Actually, Luke actually tells us, Luke chapter 2 tells us that many were looking for the redemption, not of their sins, but of Jerusalem. But not Moses, not David, not Nehemiah, none of the past leaders would be able to do what this one came to do. He will save his people from their sins. What are our sins? What are the sins that you're dealing with today? Fear? Pride? Selfishness? Anger? Idolatry? Impatience, fornication, adultery. What sin are you struggling with today? Who can deliver you from that sin? Listen, the pastor cannot, your friends cannot, your parents cannot, your teachers cannot, your deacons cannot, your elders cannot. No man can deliver you. No system can deliver you from those sins. The hymn writer asked the question, what can wash away my sins? And then he answers himself, nothing but the blood of Jesus. And then he asks himself again, what can make me whole again? See, that's what sin does. It makes us feel less than complete. It makes us feel empty and alienated. What can make me whole again? And then he answers, nothing but the blood of Jesus. And then he just forgets asking questions and he just starts to praise God. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Listen. The Bible says that the name of Jesus is an easy name, it's an exalted name, it's an exclusive name, and Acts 4:12 says there is salvation in no other, there's no other name given under heaven among men by which we must be saved. That's the only name. Do you want to go to heaven? Do you want to know God? Do you want to be delivered from your sins? Do you want to be made whole again? If so, then there's only one person that you must go to, you must lean upon, you must commit yourself to, that you must rely upon, and it's Jesus. Because Jesus can do for you what no other person can. He can deliver you. What is the divine revelation? It is personal. God wants you to understand it personally. What is the revelation? It is Christ-centered. It's about Jesus. And who is he? He is God who comes to save. Some people think that he is God come to teach. But no, he is God who comes to save. You say, well, how does he do it? And here is the stupendous, marvelous thing. Here's the life-altering thing. Now, come up close and listen. How does Jesus save us from our sins? Is it by rules? No. Is it by religion? No. Is it by some sort of force or some sort of fear tactic? No. Jesus saves us from our sins by dying. 1 Peter 3:18, for Christ died for our sins, the just for the unjust, to bring us to God. He saves us by dying. He saves us by rising from the dead. Romans 5:10 says, "For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, much more having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life." He saves us by dying. He saves us by rising. But he saves us by sharing his own life with us. The Bible says in John 6:40, "For this is the will of my Father," Jesus said, "that everyone who beholds the Son and believes in him will have eternal life, and I myself will raise him up on the last day." Jesus said, "It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words I have spoken to you are spirit and are life." This is how he saves: by dying in our place, by rising and conquering death, by sharing his life with those who believe. We go through all of these celebrations, these parties, these gift-giving and decorating of homes during this holiday season. We get all caught up in those things. And the meaning and the message of Christmas is really about knowing God as your personal Lord and Savior. That's it. He came into the world, born of a virgin, uniquely the Son of God, God walking around in a body, and his Father said, "Call him Jesus, for he is going to save his people from their sins." He went to a cross. He hung there between heaven and earth. He paid the penalty for your sin and mine. He fulfilled the prophecy that his Father had spoken of him when he was named. Today, he is in heaven at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for all who believe. And if you will ever be saved, you must trust in the name of Jesus and in the Jesus of the name. You must. And without him, there's no hope. There's no future. There's really no meaning in life, in this life. He came to give you what you can't get anyplace else. And what is that? The forgiveness of sins. The forgiveness of sins. The divine revelation is personal. It's Christ-centered. But let me end with this last one. It is scriptural. God's revelation is always biblical. It's always scriptural. It's personal, yes. God doesn't want you to have a second-hand religion. It's a first-hand knowledge. God's revelation is Christ-centered. It's all about Jesus. It's about his person. It's about his work. It's about his mission. But God's revelation is always to be found in the Bible. Always in the Bible. Now, in this last closing section, I want you to notice it carefully, beginning in verse 22 and verse 23, and it has a very important lesson that I want to end on. Verse 22. Now notice Matthew says, "Now all this took place to fulfill what was spoken by the Lord through the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall be with child and shall bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel," which translated means "God with us." What Matthew is telling us is that not only is there forgiveness in Jesus, that Jesus will bring forgiveness of his people's sins, but Jesus is going to do something else. Did you see it? What is he going to do? He is going to bring about the realization that the Old Testament prophets talked about. And what was that realization? If you don't know your Old Testament, then you'll miss this. So let me just tell you. There's a phrase throughout the Old Testament. It's the main focus and main expression about the purposes of God in the Old Testament. And it's this: "I will be your God and you will be my people." It's a repeated phrase. Jesus came to fulfill that purpose. He came to not only save us from our sins so that we could experience God, but he came that we might experience the presence of God, fellowship with God, friendship with God. Now, in Genesis chapter 3, we are told that God came walking in the cool of the day in fellowship with Adam. And apparently this was a regular occurrence, but something happened when sin entered into the world. The Bible says that Adam and Eve hid themselves from the presence of God. They did so because they had rebelled against God. And if you read the early chapters of Genesis, you'll see where that's recorded. They hid themselves from the presence of God. Now listen very closely. That phrase may not mean much to you because you think they're just trying to stay out of God's sight line because they had sinned against them, but it's very significant. If you go back to the book of Exodus, chapter 32, you will discover the story of the golden calf. This was a time when the children of Israel created an idol, and began to worship it in disobedience to God's commands. God declared that he was going to bring judgment on his people, and Moses did something. Moses interceded for them. And so God said, okay, I'm not going to destroy the people as they deserve. But if you go further in Exodus chapter 33, verse 3, God tells Moses, I'm not going to destroy the people, but I'm not going to go with you. I will lead you up to a land flowing with milk and honey, but I am not going to be in your midst. I'm not going to go with you. And he said he would not go with them lest he destroy them on the way because they were an obstinate people. Well, we're told that when God told Moses that, his response was this: Lord, don't do that. Don't give us the promised land without giving us your presence. Because you see, Moses understood something that we need to understand today. Moses understood, he valued something, and that thing was this. Moses understood that the big thing in life was not the enjoyment of things, but the enjoyment of God's presence. Moses understood that fellowship with God was the most important thing in life. It was the thing. And if you could fellowship with God, if you could know his presence in your life, then it would satisfy everything else. He got that. He said, Lord, don't give us the promised land if you're not going to be with us. And the Bible teaches that God in his kindness said to Moses, my presence shall go with you and I will give you rest. And it was because of this that Moses was able to experience and know what life was all about. Listen, let me try to make it real plain and simple. The big thing in life is not things, it's not achievements, but it's about experiencing what you were created for. You were created for fellowship with God. That's what God made you for. And you will never be complete until you know that. Jesus came to give us that. This is why the Genesis 3:8 is such a tragic picture. Adam and Eve are hiding from the presence of their maker. They're hiding from the one person who created them to enjoy his presence. That's a picture of what sin does to us. In sin, we hide ourselves from the one thing we're created for. Matthew is telling us, by using this text, Jesus came not only to bring forgiveness, but Jesus came to bring the presence of God with him, so that we can have fellowship with God, so that we can enjoy God. How does the Westminster Confession put it? What is the chief end of man? To glorify God and to enjoy him forever. God can only be enjoyed. He can only be enjoyed in Christ. This is what you were created for. This is what Jesus came to give us. Now, as I conclude, I want to press home upon you a question. Do you realize how desperately we all need forgiveness? And unless you receive the gift of forgiveness, you're not going to receive the gift of fellowship. It starts with the first gift of forgiveness, and then the gift of fellowship is possible. What would God have you to do with what you've heard today? It's real simple, and I'll try to make it that way. God would have you to acknowledge your sin, to admit your rebellion, to admit that you go your own way, you do your own thing, and that you've sinned against him. God would have you to acknowledge it. God would have you to make a clear choice to turn away from it, because it's the reason why there's so much dissatisfaction in your life. It's the reason why there's so much sadness and emptiness in your life. He would have you to make a choice to turn away from it. What would God have you to do? He would have you, by faith, to come to Jesus. And when you come to Jesus, God would have you to call upon his name for salvation, to ask him to forgive you, to ask him to cleanse you from your sins. What would God have you to do? God would have you to acknowledge your sin, to make a clear choice to turn from it, to come to Christ and to ask him for forgiveness. And then God would have you to thank Christ for giving you such a wonderful gift and tell somebody else about it. That's what God would have you to do as a result of hearing this message. Acknowledge your sin, make a clear choice to turn from it, come to Christ and call upon his name, and to thank him for his gift and tell somebody about it. Would you do that? Would you respond to God? Because of his grace. Let's pray together. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. As we come to a time like this, often Satan would try to fool you into thinking that the only way you should respond to a message from God's word is that you feel it. But that's a trick. Don't go for it. The question is, do you understand what you have heard? And if you do, and God has placed it upon your heart to respond to it, then you must act. You must not wait upon feelings, but you must act upon what you have heard. And you must act based upon God's word. Would you acknowledge your sin, your rebellion against God, doing your own thing, going your own way? Would you make a choice today to turn from it with God's help? Because that's the very thing that's causing such a dissatisfaction in your life. Would you come to Jesus by faith? Would you call upon him? Ask him to save you. Ask him to forgive you. He promised that he would not cast you out. Would you thank Jesus for giving himself for you? Just go ahead and thank him for his offering of love. Thank him for his sacrifice. Thank him for his love and his mercy. And then to prove that you are not ashamed, tell somebody of what you've done before this day is over. Father, I pray now. I pray for those who, for the very first time, have been led by your Spirit to call upon your name. Father, that you would give them an assurance that only you can give. Not only a conviction of sin, but an assurance of forgiveness through Jesus Christ. But I pray, Lord, for your people. Lord, that as we come to this time, that this would not be just about evangelism, but it will be about your grace in our lives, that you've come to save us not just from the penalty of sin, but the very power of sin. And someday you will save us from the presence of sin. And so, Jesus, we call upon you now to save us from the power of remaining sin in our flesh, that we would find victory over those things that trouble us and cause us to turn our eyes away from you, just like Robert Robertson, that we would come back to you. I pray this in your precious name.